Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 23rd meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2024. The first item on the committee's agenda is to invite our new member, James Dornan, to declare any relevant interests.
Thank you, Convener. I have no relevant interest to declare.
Thank you very much indeed. And can I also take the opportunity of thanking Fulton McGregor for his brief spell on the committee. The next agenda item is again for the committee to decide whether or not to take agenda items 4 and 5 this morning in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. And our main item this morning is further consideration of the 2022-23 audit of the Water Industry Commission for Scotland, which involved a Section 22 report being issued. Can I welcome our witnesses this morning who are both from the Water Industry Commission for Scotland and from the Scottish Government. So first of all, can I welcome Michelle Quinn, who's here as the interim Director General Net Zero. She's joined by Kirsty Burge, who's here, the Director of Energy and Climate Change in that DG. And we're also joined by Catherine Williams, who's the Deputy Director of Water Policy in the Scottish Government. From the Water Industry Commission, we've got David Satty, who's the Interim Chief Executive, Donald McRae, who's the Chair of the Board, and we're also joined by Robin McGill, who's the Chair of the Audit and Risk Committee, as well as being a member of the Board of WICS. We've got some questions to put to you, but before I get to those, I'm going to invite, first of all, Donald McRae to make a short opening statement. Mr. McRae.
Well, good morning, Convener, and good morning, Committee. Can I start by saying that WICS accepts the need for a greater focus on value for money and the need to operate to the highest standard of financial management? Today, we want to tell you about the changes at WICS since last December to meet those needs and to answer questions on the 685 pages of submissions which we have made to you. WICS is, of course, the economic regulator of Scottish Water, but supports the hydronation strategy of the Scottish Government to the extent of generating international income of 1.2 million in the last audited financial year, which is 22% of total income. So what changes have taken place at WICS since December? Well, the CEO and accountable officer resigned effective from 31st of December last year. That has allowed a change of culture and a rapid refocus on value for money. We have an interim CEO, an interim accountable officer in place since March, and he's sitting on my right. We have seen the departure of one long-serving board member and welcomed two new board members. We have revised policies on travel and expenses with the focus on full compliance. And we have reinstated our approvals panel to ensure that all significant expenditure has the required approvals in place. We have started a comprehensive change programme, reviewing roles and responsibilities and improving internal governance. We are happy to report on progress today, taking account of the need to respect the rights and privacy of some of the individuals involved. I want to end by thanking all the staff at WICS who contributed to the 685 pages of submissions made to this committee while continuing to carry on with the important task of economic regulation. My colleagues are here, David Satty on my right, Interim CEO, Interim Accountable Officer, and Robin McGill, who chairs our Audit and Risk Committee.
Thank you very much, Mr. McRae. I'm now going to invite Michelle Quinn to also make a short opening statement. Ms. Quinn.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. On the 2nd of September, I took up the role of Interim Director General Net Zero, whilst my colleague Roy Brannan takes a leave of absence for medical reasons. I'm joined today by my colleagues Kirsty Burge, Director of Energy and Climate Change, and Catherine Williams, who is the Interim Deputy Director covering this area since mid-June. The previous Deputy Director in the post is no longer with the Scottish Government. Since the last session, you have received letters from both the Scottish Government and from WICS, providing you with the additional information that you sought. Our focus now is on resolving the issues raised, ensuring that our public bodies demonstrate the good practice principles of governance that people expect, and we have made good progress in several areas. We have commissioned two reviews, an independent review of WICS and an internal review of our own sponsorship arrangements. And as you've heard, ministers have appointed two new non-executive directors on an interim basis to strengthen the WICS board. In the meantime, colleagues have continued to strengthen the sponsorship function and reset our relationship with WICS, ensuring that we align with the key principles of the Ryan Review of the Scottish Government's relationship with public bodies, providing clarity on accountabilities, taking a systematic approach to assurance, ensuring that there are clear risk management processes in place, including escalation routes, and ensuring that there is appropriate capacity and capability within the Scottish Government sponsorship team. We have also strengthened our assurance within the DG Net Zero portfolio. And whilst we welcome the immediate steps taken by WICS to address financial and governance issues, the Grant Thornton report was provided to you as part of WICS' letter on the 31st of July. It clearly illustrates that there is much more to be done in this area. We want to ensure that we are learning the lessons from this work across government, and the Scottish Government Public Bodies Support Unit is assisting us in embedding those lessons in our approach to sponsorship. In terms of next steps, the external review is in the process of being finalised, and we will be considering the findings from that review carefully. And today, my colleagues and I will endeavour to address your queries in order to assist the committee in the preparation of your own report. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. And just to place on record the committee's thanks for the amount of information that you did provide us with. There was a delay in publication because some of the information had to be redacted. But we'll come on to some of the substance of those documents and what they tell us. And it was useful, I think, for Mr. McRae to remind us at the very outset that the whole purpose of the Water Industry Commission for Scotland is to ensure that Scottish water provides long-term value for money and is best in class, or has best in class levels of service. And I'm sure that we will scrutinise whether WICS lives up to those standards during the course of this morning. Can I begin, and it might be a question that I'll direct to Robin McGill, because back in October of last year, Audit Scotland wrote to you, Mr. McGill, or sent an email to you regarding the business case for the Harvard Business School course, in which they questioned why it was that when it came to expenditure over £20,000, that was something that required approval by the Scottish Government, while the board's approval level was for expenditure over £100,000. And I think the expression used in that email was, this seems the wrong way around. Is that something which you have addressed?
Yes, we have. It's been corrected and now the levels have flipped. So we'll see everything that's novel, contentious or above a much, much lower level. And the level's not set as one level for different kinds of expenditure. So that situation could never arise again where someone could bypass the board and the Scottish Government at the same time because of their belief they didn't need to go to either. And that was part of the challenge. I would say that the letter I got from Audit Scotland was ahead of them finalising and publishing their audit. And it highlighted not only that, but a whole series of other concerns about behaviour. And that's what really got the board and myself fired up, because a lot of these things were unknown to us and quite surprising, and we jumped into action based on that. And they were at pains to point out, and I'll repeat it just for completeness, that all of the issues, the financial issues, were below the levels of materiality and they didn't qualify the accounts in any way. Having said that, the behaviours that were highlighted and a pattern of behaviour caused us real concern.
Okay. I mean, when you appeared before us in March, what you told us at that point was that through your committee meetings, we had regular conversations about public reaction to excessive spend. There was a lot of pushback, but we kept up that challenge. So which is it? Was it a surprise that this was the way governance arrangements were working and this was how the approval was being interpreted, or was that a long-standing battle that you were having with the former chief executive officer?
Both, actually. I can go back to May 22, and the ARC was having a strong debate because there had been several issues of non-compliance with expenses back then, and we were challenging the executive and the chief executive to say, you know, we need to do something about this. And the argument back, call it pushback if you like, the argument back was...
Pushback.
Well, okay, well, we're talking about two different things. I'm talking about the review that was done prior to any of this. So what we said to them, why are these things happening? And they said, post-COVID, there's rapid inflation in both travel, hotel bills, meal bills, and the existing process for expenses, and I'm only talking about expenses now, not any other kind of procurement, was straining at the seams. So we said to them, right, if we need to be able to do our job, and if you can't do your job, and there was more than anecdotal evidence that people were cancelling out of conferences and courses and things they should be going on to fulfil the obligations of their role, we said, go away and come back with a proposal that we can consider and the board can consider how we address the challenges of an inflationary post-COVID world. So they did. And we looked at that much later and embarked on a six-month pilot to see if that would help people be compliant, because we wanted them to be compliant, and also see if it would help them actually meet with the realities of that world. So that was going on since the beginning of 2022, and that continued all the way through. The things I was talking about that were surprising were things that we knew nothing about, and that's why they were surprising.
Could you give us an example of that?
Well, for instance, the Harvard Executive Education course. It hadn't come across the ARC and it hadn't been across the board. It was a complete surprise to us.
Mr. McRae, were you surprised at that as well?
I was surprised because the board were not presented with the proposal or the proposed expenditure or even the business case. So, in my view, that is something that we needed to rectify, and we did that quickly. That doesn't mean that we would want to see everything, but it does mean that we're trying to instill in everybody a change of culture, whereas where a decision like that on that size of expenditure is considered to be novel and contentious, even although it might not fit below or above any kind of rule. But what's important is that the executive, and in particular the interim chief executive here, will take a view on any kind of expenditure which technically may be within the rules or guidance, but which really needs for board approval, and that would be judged novel or contentious. And that's something we're working on quite a lot. And the rule, I suppose the rule now is, if in any doubt, you have to put it to the board for approval.
Okay, okay. And just as we're at the start of this morning's session, can I ask you to remind us how many employees Wix has?
Wix currently have 21 employees. There are some unfilled vacancies at this moment in time, but we are a small organisation.
Small organisation. And I think previously we've been told that there were 24 employees. I don't know whether that's the full establishment, but 24 employees. Could you tell us, out of those 24 employees, how many of them had corporate credit cards?
So I would have to get, as you said, the numbers of staff have changed over that time. I would have to get the exact number for you, Convener. But corporate credit cards were issued to the leadership team within the organisation, some members of corporate, and analysts who were undertaking international work. At this moment in time, travel and expenses are incurred in personal cards now. So the use of corporate credit cards is not what it used to be.
Okay, because the Grant Thornton report refers to flights to Rwanda. So there are still flights to Rwanda going on, and a flight to Brasilia, which was paid for out with the orthodox means of booking travel. Could you explain that a little bit more?
Before we do that, I'm going to ask David to do that, but can I just emphasise the point about cards and put that into perspective, because David has some statistics on what the situation is now on the use of cards before we go on to answer that question on Rwanda, for example?
So, if the, as of now, there are 14 credit cards still in circulation, but there's only one that is in active use, and that is in the operational side of the business for the purchase of IT. So there is only, we don't as a standard utilise corporate credit cards for ongoing travel and subsistence.
Okay, so can you tell me about the examples unearthed in the Grant Thornton report about employees who booked? I mean, I get, if I'm called to a meeting in London tomorrow or I need to get to Stornoway on Saturday, I might at short notice cut through the bureaucracy and just make my own booking. But a flight to Brasilia, a flight to Kigali, business class? Why was that done in the way that it was, and who did it?
So the first thing to say there, Convener, is that was highlighted in the internal transactions report which Wix undertook. So following the departure of the former CEO, Wix undertook a full review of all transactions during the 22-23 year, partly to help quantify the issues by the Auditor General, and then continued through the last 9 months that the former CEO was in post. We highlighted those two particular flights in the internal transactions report, and then Grant Thornton then surfaced that Grant Thornton was asked to independently verify the internal transactions report to make sure that it was robust and as comprehensive, and then look at the final quarter of the 22-24 year. Those two particular trips, both were for the former chief executive. One was an international water association conference. That was the one in Rwanda. The other was a peer review that the former CEO was undertaking in Brasilia, commissioned by the OECD. And both were booked by the former CEO by himself and on his own credit card, which wasn't in line with policy at that point in time. Policy was to utilise CTM, the government-approved travel provider, unless you could demonstrate that better value could be achieved elsewhere.
Okay, and right. Okay, let me move on. One of the other ambiguities which came out during the audit was the application or the interpretation of the £75 gift threshold, which is set. Again, can I just ask where you have got to with reviewing that? Because it seemed to be applied in such a way that it looked like people were trying to get around it.
Could I answer to that, Convener, by saying that this is an area where we also would like some more clarity. We haven't got that quite yet, but I think it's worthwhile explaining the context. And David, can you enlighten us a little bit on the £75 limit, which has been applied in a way which we didn't quite agree with?
So the £75 threshold is part of our governance framework. There is a number of thresholds. Robin was speaking to that earlier, and the interpretation up until the 22-23 audit was that was a threshold per person, whereas in its audit, its external audit for the 22-23 accounts, Audit Scotland interpreted that as per gift, and as a result, the rather than looking at £100 gifts, the Amazon gifts that we discussed when we Audit Scotland looked at it in its totality. At this moment in time, we are not we're not engaging in any gifts, and we are engaging with the Scottish Government on our governance framework as we speak. And this will be an area that we will seek to clarify, Convener.
Okay, thanks. I mean, one of the other areas which is highlighted in the Audit Scotland report, and which again I think is also brought out by the Grant Thornton review, is the whole policy around reimbursing people for meals. And some of the terminology I don't quite understand, non-city meals and city meals and limits and I mean, we were told again, I think by Mr. Brannan, Ms. Quinn, at the last session that the use of credit cards involves a no drink policy. But it's pretty obvious, isn't it, from the findings that have been unearthed by Grant Thornton, that unless people were eating huge amounts of food, a large proportion of those claims, some of them without receipts, were made for alcohol. I mean, can you confirm that, first of all?
Yes, I can confirm that the expenses policy at the time did not prohibit the consumption of alcohol. The policy that we do have in place now, that is no longer the case. Alcohol is not something that the staff can consume and have reimbursed.
So it's a no alcohol policy now?
No alcohol policy now.
Okay, okay. So perhaps if I turn to Michelle Quinn, so one of the other things which has come out of the evidence that we've seen so far is that the former deputy director was also present at some of these meals which involved purchasing alcohol with the credit card. What's the position of the DG Net Zero on that?
So we have also become aware of that, as you have. The Mr. Brannan, in his correspondence with you, made it clear that that is something that the former deputy director regretted that he didn't make more clear to you within his evidence submission at the time. We, within the Scottish Government, as Mr. Brannan said, we have a policy where we do not reimburse staff for alcohol, and nor, to my knowledge, have we been asked to do so. We do expect that staff registers any gifts or hospitality that they receive over a value of £15, and we keep a register to that effect. And it would be my expectation that the former deputy director would have done that.
I mean, rather than participating in something like that, don't you think it would have been his role actually to challenge that?
Well, I think there may be a role there to do that. And in the event that he was unsure of that, had he registered the potential for the receiving hospitality, his line manager would have become aware of it and been able to have that conversation with him.
Why would that be something that he would be unsure of?
Well, he's not here to answer for himself, so I'm afraid I'm not able to say that. I'm just saying that in the event that he was unsure, or if he felt that there was any ambiguity over that, had he had the conversation with his line manager directly, or indeed registered the potential for hospitality, that conversation would have happened.
Final question from me. Does the Scottish Government have a limit on what staff can spend on meals per head?
We do have a limit. I don't have that immediately at my disposal, but I'm happy to provide that to you.
Okay.
It's a relatively modest sum, and expenses need to be receipted in that regard.
Kirsty Berg, yeah.
I think it's around £25 per head, but we'll give you the exact figure.
So a meal at Lescargo Blanc in Edinburgh, where the cost was £140 per head, £315 of the total bill of £562 was spent on alcohol, is out with your policy.
Considering yes. So. Yes.
Thank you. Graeme Simpson wants to come in, then I'll go to James Dawn.
Thanks, Graeme. Convener. It's just to follow up on this line of questioning around meals. Mr. Satie, you wrote to the convener on July the 31st to say there are no more meals out on expenses of over £50. So does that mean that the practice of claiming for meals has stopped?
Yes, so there's two things to say to that, Mr. Simpson. So the first one is the use of corporate credit cards. So that has stopped. And if staff were to put forward any travel and subsistence which isn't compliant, they won't get reimbursed for it. So that's clear in the policy, and that policy is in operation and it's working. The second point is that we do have a limit, the limit for a meal in Edinburgh is £20, and there is no longer the alcohol is not permitted as part of the policy.
Is that £20 a head or £20
it's
in 20 total?
Pounds, £20 per head, Mr. Simpson.
Yeah. So you could take out a large group and accrue quite a large bill, but you'd only get £20 a head.
So the policy would be that the limit is £20 per person, yes.
Okay.
I will bring Mr. Simpson in again later on. But James Dornan, over to you, James.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, panel. My questions are to Wicks. So, given your governance framework, which establishes the policies and procedures that you should follow in the delivery of its functions, and it clearly sets out the limits of the delegated financial authorities, how is it possible for these to be misinterpreted?
Can I ask David to answer that question and concentrate on maybe one example? Have you one example in mind that you want some clarity
on? Listen to the example that Mr. Satti is going to give us and then... I thought he was going to give us one. What I was going to say was, you talked about the board not seeing everything, but you're meant to get prior Scottish Government approval before obtaining and incurring expenditure for any purpose that might be considered novel, contentious or repercussive. Did the board get to see anything that could be considered that? Or was that just that it was left to the previous chief executive and it's all coming out in the wash now or whatever?
Well, can I start the answer and David can come in? But the relationship between the board and the executive, including the chief executive, is vital for good governance. Now, the board have to monitor, oversee and approve the actions of the executive. But in order to do that, we have to have the information, and not only that, but the culture in the organisation which makes the executive or allows the executive to put any proposition forward, which, as I said before, may be technically within the rules, but requires a bit of judgment about what is novel and contentious. Now, we were not presented, for example, with the business case for the Harvard Business School course. We had also clean reports from Audit Scotland and Internal Audit for every year until December 23. What has changed then, and this answers your question before I go to David for a little bit more detail, it's really important to change the culture. And by that I mean that the executive, mainly the chief executive, comes to the board with a proposal for expenditure that might be viewed as novel and contentious. Has that happened? It has happened. It's been made possible by the departure of the previous CEO and by the interim CEO involving the board, not just as a source of monitoring, oversight and approval, but advice, help and guidance. That's a change in culture which David has worked very hard at, we and the board have worked very hard at, and we are confident now that a proper judgment has been made on anything that might be viewed as novel or contentious. Now, I want to pick up on a point that was made in one of those reports. It asked, can you define novel and contentious? Well, I'm sorry, that's very difficult to do, and that's where it requires judgment. But we recognise that, and we are encouraging the executive, including the chief executive, to take a view that if there's any doubt, then you put it to the board. David, do you want to add anything to that?
Yes. When one of the one of the key actions when we embarked on the phase one of the action plan, Mr. Dornan, was to introduce or reinstate an approvals panel. So all the directors scrutinising expenditure approvals, including scrutinising whether or not these are seen as novel and contentious. as a way to then discuss whether or not we as an executive are demonstrating value for money, and also to then have a conversation as to whether or not that is something that should go to the board, even though it's below the thresholds. That's in place at the moment. An example of that, you know, is one in March, where one of my colleagues, it was an expenditure proposal that I put forward for £15,000, and one of my colleagues rejected it on the basis that he didn't think I'd considered all options. And that's the type of challenge that exists now within the organisation. And, you know, the expenditure approval was revisited and the options considered, and the proposal was a lot better as a result. That is the process that's in place now. It wasn't in place during the final years of the former CEO's tenure.
I think there's
an important point there. It's a big cultural shift from overseeing and approving historical events to getting people to approve them in advance and discuss them in advance and be very open and ask the board's advice. That is a major cultural shift, and that's now in place. And I must admit, it's made my job a lot easier.
It has, but can I ask, how did you get to a situation where you are spending all that money on training courses for senior staff, with one part of the organisation feeling free to do it and the board being completely unaware of it?
Well, could I start the answer to that, Mr. Dornan and convener? At WIC, staff are our most important asset, and we consider it essential to invest in our people. That aids both recruitment and retention. And that's why over the last 8 years, we have invested on average 1.5% of revenue per year on all types of training, from cyber resilience to management development. It's important to benchmark these figures as well. And for the last 8 years, another major organisation, public body, has invested on average 2.5% per year on off operating income. Now, the executive education, which has been referred to, is a subset of the overall training. And the policy of paying for MBAs for senior staff has been in place since 2004. And the policy was presented to the Scottish Government Remuneration Group in 2017. And it was viewed as an aid to recruitment and retention. And I can tell you that the tenure of analysts who have an MBA was 2.4 years, and the tenure of analysts with an MBA was 8.7 years. So in other words, that policy was really effective in that case. But let me give you the overall picture as well. Over the last 20 years, four members of staff have been given the opportunity. Now, that to me doesn't represent an excessive amount of investment in training, but taking account of all the comments that have been made about training and executive education, we have committed to a review of all training, and we are developing a policy on training which every member of staff can subscribe to.
Okay, can I just come in there and say, look, I don't think anybody is criticising the fact that you spend money on training. That's very important, that your staff are well trained and that they get everything that's available. I think the issue here is, were you doing the best value for money audit on it? And now, I'm sure in most cases you were. There seems to be some cases where that's dubious. But that, I think that's the issue here. And why did you not have oversight of that?
Well, can I just answer that question about the particular case, which has been questioned many times. And I have accepted personally, and also on behalf of the board, that we did not see the business case for that particular proposition. The policy was in place for a number of years, and overall, we are in favour of investing in our staff and executive development. But David, do you want to add anything to that?
Well, maybe Robin, well, I'll go back to something the Auditor General said in the first PAC meeting. You can only audit what you can see. And if people, their value judgment is, I can make this decision without reference to anyone else. That's very hard to find in an audit.
Can I, on that point, then, I completely accept that. Right, I think that's. But how did you get to a situation where somebody in your organisation was making decisions that, that seemed to be so out of the norm?
Well, it probably has evolved, and that culture evolved, and that style evolved over time. And where we were making interventions where we could see things that weren't right, I talked about the pilot to completely rejig expenses and the process used back in 22. So we were doing those kind of things, but we were dealing with what we were seeing and what we were finding. And I'll go back to the letter from Audit Scotland that they sent me in advance of them issuing their audit, where they highlighted a number of things that they've been made aware of and they've seen that we hadn't seen, and we were really surprised.
Okay. So. Can I go on to Mr. Sati? You have now removed the retainer for the services of the KC. Why is the retainer no longer required, and why was it in place for so long?
Yes, so one of the first actions that I did, Mr. Dornan, was to look at the retainer. So for clarity, Wix had retained the services of a member of the King's Council and paid the retainer each quarter for that. And any commissions that, that was undertaken as part of that was then via our legal advisers. And I looked at that retainer. I met with the legal advisers not long after I was appointed interim CEO. And while a value for money a case could be made, I didn't feel comfortable with the services or having that and paying for that as a service. I understand that when you're engaging with a KC at that level, it does cost thousands of pounds per hour. And it would be prior to instructing a KC, you need to incur not just the services of the KC to bring him up to speed, but you need to incur costs with your legal advisors to bring him up to speed. And if an organisation was utilising the services of a KC frequently enough, you could make a case for that. But I don't think Wix requires the services of a KC at that level of frequency, and therefore decided to remove the retainer.
OK, thanks for that.
Could I add to that an important point? That is perfectly valid for the situation where Wix is today, but this arrangement was in place for many years, and importantly, it was in place just not long after the formation of Wix, and actually the formation of Scottish Water, when the absolute top-notch, if you like, business advice and legal advice was required instantly. So I think a business case could well have been made at that point, not so strong business case at this moment, which is why David made that decision.
Yep. Okay, I appreciate that. But can you tell me, is it normal for a KC to be kept in retainer by public bodies? That's a serious question. I don't know the answer to
it. I couldn't answer the question as to whether or not it's normal. I just know, having looked at the facts for Wix, I couldn't justify it.
Thank you.
But also, I think I would make the point that what Wix does is really quite unusual. And the law and interpretation of the law is critical, particularly when changes are happening and our relationship with Scottish Water and how we go about doing our job. So I'm not sure if that would apply to many or other bodies of our size, but what we do is actually quite complicated. We spent a lot of time in the board becoming amateur lawyers trying to figure out how do we navigate the law as such as it is, and how do we make sure that Scottish Water deliver the best performance that they can.
Okay. Okay.
Can I just add to that we all feel on the board that it's our duty to make sure that we have the best legal advice on lots of issues, not just about the departure of former chief executives, but also about the important matters of regulation, which is the main part of our business, actually. And I do go back to the point that Scottish Water and Wix were set up not that long ago, and we needed to have access to that level of opinion easily and quickly, and I believe that a business case could well have been made at that time, but not so much nowadays.
Okay, thank you. Last question I've got, I think, is for Mr. Sati and Mr. McGill. It's about 3X1 Group, which appears to provide a PR consultancy service. Is this correct?
Do you want to start?
I can start, yeah. So When the news of the... So the first thing is the point I made earlier, Mr. Durnan, which we are a small organisation and we don't have the expertise in-house in order to assist with the magnitude of press inquiries we've never had to have the expertise of engaging with the press in the way that we have as an organisation thus far. So when the news of the Section 22 broke, upon recommendation of the board at that point in time was to engage with specialist advice that could help us. And we had that advice in place during the last couple of weeks in December, and then we went out and procured services for the initial 3 months, which is now which we it was supposed to be for a 3 month period, but given the size, the amount of, we managed to stretch out the value of the contract until pretty much now, so we still have the services of that particular company.
So you received all required approvals from the board, etc. But was it a single tender contract or by competitive tender?
No, we got multiple quotes from various organisations, and 3X1, who's on the Scottish Government framework, was seen as the one that the entity would provide the greatest value for money.
Okay, thank you very much.
Just to confirm on behalf of the board that the board did actually request the interim CEO to go ahead and went through all the process required, and I can confirm how valuable that has been in the last few months.
Mr. McCrae, you're very bullish there, saying we need the best legal advice. Did that go out to any kind of procurement process?
David, I think you can answer that one easily.
Yes, so we have a legal services framework which we competitively tender for 6 years, which is the duration of our corporate planning period. So we do have the legal advisors we have in place has been competitively tendered, and the rates that we receive from that particular firm has been locked in for the 6 years.
This is Shepherd and Wedderburn.
It is. Yes.
So who previously have been your legal advisors over the course of the last 20 years?
I would have to come back to you over the course of the last 20 years, but I can confirm that Shepherd and Wedderburn were in place in the last corporate planning period as well.
Okay. Mr. McCrae, but you were answering questions in the context of being asked about the KC's retention. Did the KC position, formerly a QC, go out to some kind of tendering process?
David, I think you can answer that. You were there, frankly, long before I was there.
So when we undertook the review of transactions, the reason why that is in it is because that is something, looking at our policies now, we would see that as a single tender purchase and is therefore non-compliant as a result. So I'm not aware of it being competitively tendered, and that was one of the reasons, Mr. Leonard, why we removed the retainer.
And was that the same KC throughout the 20 years, or did that change at any point?
I would have to come back on the last 20 years, but I know that there has been a long-standing relationship with the former CEO in this particular KC.
What do you mean by a long-standing relationship?
In that this particular individual was, the KC that is, was seen as having the requisite legal expertise, and that the former CEO utilised those expertise. So I would say for more than a decade, perhaps as close to 2 decades.
Okay, well, if you've got any more information on that, that might be useful. I think both the Deputy Convener and Graeme Simpson want to come in with a quick question in this area. So I'm going to bring in Jamie Green first, and then I'll come to Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Good morning to our panel. On this line of questioning, so, Mr. Sati, I'm just trying to get my head around this. So there's a case he was on retainer for a considerable period of time. It's unclear how that relationship came around, whether it was procured under due process or it was simply a relationship on a one-to-one level with the former CEO and the individual. But nonetheless, that relationship endured. You said you've cancelled since that ongoing payment. I'm not sure if you're able to share the approximate value of that contract, but I presume it will pop up in some accounts. If you could let us know how much that is, that would be helpful. But more importantly is, if by its removal, does that leave a gap in your ability to get proper high-level advice around the nature of the work that you're supposed to be doing? So will you have to go out and retender this work, in other words?
So, Mr. Green, this is part of the assessment that I was making. So when I met with the legal advisors, the way the process works is, if our legal advisors believe they need the skills and expertise of a KC, then they can subcontract and go directly to King's Counsel. And they could, if they so wished, and the individual was available, go to that individual who was on retainer. So there isn't a gap there as such, other than there is a risk that the one particular individual who has been used and understands the water industry may not be available, either because he's doing work elsewhere or he's conflicted. So there isn't a gap as such. We can utilise the services of a KC if our legal advisers really felt it was necessary going forward.
Okay, and can I ask the Scottish Government here, were you aware of the fact that a public body had a senior counsel on retainer? Is that normal practice in public bodies, or is that abnormal?
I'm not aware of any other circumstance that that's the case, but...
Yeah. So we were not aware of that they had the DG and I were not aware that Wicks had the KC on retainer, QC on retainer.
Right. Despite the fact he was on retainer for a number of years, no one in the government knew about it.
So I was not aware of it, and the DG wasn't aware of it. I am not aware through our records whether there was awareness of it. So that's my understanding.
Okay, I'll let my colleague, Mr. Simpson, perhaps come in.
Great.
How many KCs are on retainers under the public purse?
I personally am not aware of any.
Well, we've heard of one. Not now.
I can only answer within the bounds of my knowledge, and I don't know of any.
Okay. I want to ask about this PR agency, 3x1. Mr. Satti, you wrote on June the 11th about a drip of headlines. Is that why you took on 3x1, to minimise that?
The reason why we took on 3x1 is because, Mr. Simpson, we just don't have the skills and expertise within the organisation. And I've never had the need to. The way in which we regulate Scottish Water has always been in behind the scenes. We're not a public-facing organisation, and we tend not to deal with significant inquiries from the press. So that is a skills gap for a small organisation. As an executive and as a board, felt that we need to fill that skills gap temporarily, given the press scrutiny that is underway.
Yeah, so the press FOI requests and everything else.
So this is a temporary contract?
Yes, yes.
And how much are you paying them?
So the contract that we had in place was for £30,000, and that was went through a procurement process. That was initially supposed to be for January to March, but we've managed to stretch that contract out until now, Mr. Simpson.
So it ends now, does it?
It ends now, but we are looking at whether or not we need to continue to have services again. So we, back to the conversation about novelly contentious, this was one of the areas where we as an executive thought that it's below the threshold for the board, but it could be seen as novelly contentious. So let's take the approval to the board and outline the value for money case. And that was discussed very recently, and we will go out again to procure and make sure that we are achieving value for money.
Okay. I've just got one more question, because I've got others later, but just in the same email where you talk about this drip of headlines, you also And you refer, I think it was Mr. McRae referred to it, say WICs spent on average 1.5% of revenues on training, brackets, less than Audit Scotland, I believe. Do you think it was appropriate to bring in Audit Scotland into that email?
Are you asking me, any of you?
Mr.
Simpson?
Yeah, Mr. McRae, you asked that.
I'm very conscious of the need to benchmark, and I was keen to establish figures from other public bodies because, as somebody has mentioned before, you keep asking, or I've been asked, how do you compare to other public bodies? So I thought it would be useful just to get a handle on that sort of figure and look at the level of investment that was made as training. And that information was very kindly available from the annual report and accounts, and that's what I used. I'd be happy to be corrected if they aren't right.
Okay. Well, you didn't use it. It was Mr. Satie's email. I just wonder why he picked on Audit Scotland. Was it because they've written a damning report about you?
I used it in my email to Mr. McGill, if I'm aware, partly from the conversations that I was having with the chair at the time. So I was making Robin aware of the discussions that were happening between me and Donald.
We were casting around looking for how do we benchmark ourselves. There's no ulterior motive, Mr. Simpson. It was just, it was something we could get quickly, and it was just like a point on a curve, and we thought, okay, then that's fine. But that's worth mention. We could go on and look at all these other public bodies. It's all publicly available information.
Seems like a bit of a dig at Audit Scotland. Anyway, I'll leave it there.
Anyway, I'm not going to steal Colin Beattie's thunder, so I'm going to go straight over to him to ask you some questions about your staff training policy.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I'd like to look a bit about staff training, particularly initially about the MBA situation. WICS FOI response on the 10th of July this year, there was a copy of an approval form for a member of staff to attend the executive MBA programme at the London Business School. That was on the 8th of May 2018, at a total cost of £119,300. Now, it states, to support the further development of, and the name's redacted, the employment offer included the opportunity to obtain sponsorship for the completion of an MBA executive programme. And that was important. It's in relation to the employment offer. But the Scottish Government, in the letter of 10th June, the Director General Net Zero says, the Scottish Government is aware from 2006 that WICS had a policy of funding MBAs for senior staff. And in 2014, the Scottish Government approved a WICS pay and grading restructuring, which included a fully funded MBA available after 4 years' service. Then again, in 2017, the Scottish Government, again through a revised grading structure, referred to senior members of staff being required to hold an MBA. So I guess I would ask, firstly, this MBA, is it part of the contract of employment? Was it where certain members of staff or all members of staff offered an MBA? And if so, on what terms?
I think that we have fairly full details on all those questions. I should just introduce the answer by saying that I have already said that over 20 years, four members of staff had this training. I've given you evidence to show that it improves the tenure considerably. It also enables us to have highly skilled and well-developed senior management. But David, can you give us a bit more detail about that particular course?
No, I can. So Mr. Beattie, as you said, WICS did have a policy. It does have a policy, but it's currently in pause of offering high-performing analysts who have a minimum of 4 years, but in reality it would be more of service at WICS, and the MBA would then be subjected to, or two-thirds of the cost would be subjected to a two-year lock-in, and that was on the basis of retaining members of staff. So that was the process in place. four individuals in the last 20 years have been offered that. I would have to confirm the status of your question around contracts. I'm aware of some individuals having that as part of their contract, contract of employment, yes.
I mean, it does seem to contradict the understanding of the Scottish Government in this, and maybe I would ask what the Scottish Government, Michelle Quinn, what the Scottish Government's understanding of this was. Did they understand that it was part of the contract of employment? Did they believe that there was a requirement for senior members of staff to have an MBA?
So you're correct in saying that that the policy was in place and our records show that was the case. Personally, the DG and I were not aware of that policy until June this year. But our understanding, obviously, having discussed it with Wicks, is that it is, you know, it was part of their leadership development programme.
If I can follow up, I think our assessment of this is that all staff in public sector organisations should have the training that is appropriate to allow them to discharge their roles effectively. I don't think that's unusual in the public sector or beyond. However, even regardless of the status of the MBA within individuals' contracts or not, that does not remove the duty to demonstrate best value and value for money in the procurement of that MBA. And I think I would find it difficult to understand how an MBA at Harvard, for instance, was necessary when potentially you could obtain similar knowledge and skills closer to home and possibly done in a better value way.
Coming back to this question of the MBA, it reads as if in the approval form that this member of staff accessed this course as a result of the contract of employment. And I've been asking whether the contracts of employment all offer that for senior staff or a certain grade or whatever. Mm-hmm. That's not clear to me.
And we are not privy to those contracts either in Scottish Government.
Then maybe I can come back and say, these contracts of employment, do they specifically say that the member of staff is entitled to access an MBA course?
So I'm aware, Mr. Beattie, of one contract of employment that did state that, but as standard at the moment for analysts, it isn't explicit in the way that you've just put it. So that is... and we've had conversations with analysts currently around the MBA policy, and we've made it clear to them that the prospect of a fully funded MBA is something that will not be promised going forward.
Still coming back to this, the Scottish Government's response of 10th June refers to senior members of staff being required to hold an MBA. Is that the case? And what's the definition of a senior member of staff? I mean, you're talking about analysts. That could be anything. I don't know. You know, there's all sorts of analysts. Do they require an MBA to be able to do their job? I'm asking Wicks.
So this was seen as a way to progress the skills and expertise of individuals to prepare them for senior positions within an organisation. So
has it never been a requirement that senior members of staff are required to hold an MBA?
There have been quite a number of individuals within Wicks that have filled senior positions within the organisation historically that haven't had an MBA.
Yep, but you're not answering the question, actually. Was there a requirement that senior members of staff, and I'm not sure what the definition of that is, are required to hold an MBA? Because that's the Scottish Government's understanding. So is that correct, or is it not?
So I would have to confirm that. I don't know the answer specifically of how it was in the past. What I can say is that there have been members of the WICs that have filled senior positions that haven't had an MBA.
It's still not answering the questions. As I say, I'd be grateful if you could go back and check your records on that, because either the Scottish Government's got it completely wrong or there's something else there that we really don't understand.
Yeah, I'm happy to go back and check the records on that.
Thank you.
We can and come also back about to you, Mr. Beattie. We can certainly come back to you with a definitive answer.
And also, whether employment offers included this as part of the contract. I mean, it's really a whole area of greyness there that we need to really understand as to what your policies were and how they were executed and how the communication between the Scottish Government and WICs operated. And, you know, was it open dialogue? Was the Scottish Government fully informed of how you were operating in respect to this? These are all key questions, I think. But coming back to WICs, this opportunity to obtain an MBA was supposedly essential for staff retention. Why was it considered appropriate to spend nearly £120,000 of public money to do so? And I'm talking about the specific case that I'm quoting here.
Clarify which case you are asking about.
Well, the name is redacted, so I don't have that, but it's the case where the person went to the London Business School on the 8th of May 2018, and it was in your FOI response of 10th July.
Okay, David?
So I'm, as part of the FOI, we actually highlighted the actual costs rather than the costs that were approved, Mr. Beattie. So I wasn't part of that particular approval process. It doesn't appear that the board were either. The actual costs are incurred or were highlighted as part of the FOI, and it was lower than the amount that you had highlighted. That was the policy that was in place at that point in time, and two-thirds of the cost was then subjected to a lock-in that the individual was then liable for should he decide, or he or she decide, to then leave following, you know, or out with that two-year period. So 2 years. 2 years.
Not a lot for £120,000.
We've already admitted, Mr. Beattie, that WICs needs to do a lot more in demonstrating value for money in all training and in all it does, and not approvals like that would not only be required to be approved at every level within the executive, it would also need to be approved at the board to ensure that we are demonstrating value for money going forward.
Still focusing on this money, even if it's WICs policy to cover travel and accommodation costs for courses, how is it good value for money to choose a course where £35,000 of public money is spent on travel and accommodation? That's a huge proportion. It's a lot of money.
I agree with you.
Was it your policy at that time to cover all these costs?
It was the organisation's policy at that point in time to cover the costs. And that wasn't the cost that would have been then incurred on this particular instance. But WICs fully accept the need to be demonstrating value for money. And when choosing institutions, factoring in full elements like the travel and subsistence expenditure, particularly when there are courses available in Scotland where, you know, travel and subsistence wouldn't be as high.
Presumably this travel and subsistence costs were all properly signed off.
So that if it wasn't, then it would have been deemed non-compliant expenditure, and the Audit and Risk Committee would have had sight of that. So,
Who would have signed it off?
That would have been signed off by the line manager at that point in time, which...
What level is the line manager?
The line manager at this point in time would have been the former chief executive.
Okay. So normally when I hear line manager, usually I'm looking at the boss of the unit, the department, or whatever, as opposed to, but it's a very small organisation, so yeah. Okay, the chief executive signed that off. Was that within his powers to do so?
Individual expenditure on travel and subsistence would absolutely have been. Today, had that the approval form that you're talking about, if that was ever coming close to get approval within WICS, that would have to be signed off, not just within the executive, but it would require both sign off by the board and also sign off by the government.
But at the time, the chief executive was empowered to sign off up to any limit?
So, as part of our governance framework, if something has been competitively tendered, the threshold is £100,000. If it's a single tender purchase, it's £20,000. The thresholds have been reduced for board approval versus government.
But at the time,
approval at the time that was the threshold, £120,000 for a single tender purchase. This and Audit Scotland had highlighted this when it provided evidence on the course in 22-23, in that they did not feel that the business plan or the approval form, the business case, was robust enough, and therefore the single tender purchase threshold applied. I would say that the same would be applied on this one as well, in that the lower threshold should have applied, and that the board should have got sight of that, the board should have approved it, and indeed Scottish Government should have approved it.
So you agree that retrospectively, looking back, it was inappropriate?
I agree. Looking back, I wasn't part of the approval for this particular one. What I can say now, Mr. Beattie, is that the processes and controls we have in place, that would be required, approval would be required both of the board and of the government.
Let me just cover a couple of other things on the MBA side. On the 31st July 2024, the Director General Net Zero confirmed he's not aware of any other public bodies in Scotland that require senior staff to hold MBAs. So what's different with WICS that senior staff were required to hold MBAs?
So,
and I'm still curious about the meaning of the word analyst. I don't know whether it's a post up here or a post down here.
So when we talk about analyst, the 2.5 or 2.4 years that Donald was referring to was entry level analysts. So we are talking about an analyst that has spent between 4 and 6 years within the organisation and has had progressions. Since, so it's managed to move to analyst, to senior analyst, perhaps even to manager at that point in time. Is it typical for, or why would WICS require MBAs? Well, the regulatory functions of WICS does require specialist skills and expertise. An MBA is one way of delivering that. There are multiple other ways of delivering it. As we are looking at our training policy just now, that's the question that I'm asking. It is, how do we ensure that we make our staff as capable as possible, but deliver the best possible value?
Knowing what's in an MBA, it's hard to see how an MBA is particularly appropriate as a medium to upskill people who are working as analysts within WICS.
Could I just come in there and say that you have to take account, Mr. Beattie, of the wider picture. Scottish Water is publicly owned, we all know that. The water industry in the UK is different. And in order to be part of that UK market, we have to be able to make comparisons with the private sector. And it's quite really very important that any analyst will be able to look at the accounts, for example, of private sector water companies in England and Wales, and look at it from the point of view of there being private sector, because we do make comparisons between water companies all over the UK. So it's very important that they understand the corporate thinking, and having an MBA is not absolutely required to do that, but it is very important.
Could I add, and the Harvard one in particular, now I'm aware of, I've sort of been looking into that in a bit more detail. It was an exec, I think we're using the word MBA and everyone's got in their head a different image of what that means, and it means lots of different things depending what institution you go to. This was an executive business education, and the modules chosen by the individual definitely were related to economic regulation and economics. So I'm not sure that happened in every case, because I've not looked at every case, but that certainly in this one, there was relevant training and material and knowledge gained during that course.
And just to put to bed that particular aspect, the MBA programmes, for which, have you completed your review of HR review of policies and procedures, which you said that would include a full review of staff training and the policy of funding an MBA programme? Has that been completed?
No, so it's underway. It's underway, Mr. Beattie. So one of the first steps when I took on post was to bring in HR resource into Wickes. That's the first time that Wickes has had dedicated HR in-house support in many a number of years. And as part of this work, we're looking at all policies, including the training policy. So that's work that's underway at this moment in time. But in the meantime, we have made it clear to individuals what the direction of travel is within the organisation, i.e. that we are focusing on delivering value for money, and we have to enable staff to have the skills, but do that in a way that we can justify as a public body.
Do I have time to carry on?
No, but I'll bring you back in. Should never have asked that question. But I will bring you back in if time permits, Colin. Jamie Green, Deputy Convener. Jamie.
Thank you, Convener. And I'll just maybe close off this issue of the executive training, reading the many emails of correspondence to and from, one from the former COO to yourselves, gentlemen, Donald, Robin and David. I was quite surprised by reading this email chain from March 2024, where the former CEO expressed the view that actually they had requested a much cheaper and more local option for advanced management training, but there seemed to be an insistence on North America at places like Harvard, Yale and Stanford. Why is that?
Well, can I start the answer to that? The board did not have sight of the proposal, as I said. The former CEO did have a high degree of admiration for North American business schools. That's absolutely true. And if he was here himself, I'm quite confident he would state that. But I can't speak for him completely. So all I can say is that the choice of a North American school, business school, it doesn't quite fit with what I personally would have liked to have seen. I'd have liked to have seen an exploration of better value for money alternatives. Now, that could have been possible. The business case was insubstantial. I quite accept that. Audit Scotland commented on that. I agree with that. So in future, we will make sure that our business case, if produced, is robust and to the point. David, do you want to...
Mr. Green, just to clarify, it's not the former CEO. So the CEO is still in post. So just for the record, there's no departure there. But I can confirm, so that even in a call between myself and I with the former CEO on the 17th of November, I was trying to be, I was being convinced to go to a course in the US, and that would never happen, for me personally. But I can confirm that there was a preference for US institutions.
I'm happy to correct the record that the former CEO but current COO, just to clear that.
Yes, yes.
Chief Operations Officer.
Yes, exactly.
And I'm specifically not mentioning names because our lines of question here are about processes and practices rather than individuals and personalities. So, and I want to stick to that. So let's talk about the former CEO's position and departure. I'm sure you will be expecting this to come up this morning. When did the former CEO get sight of the Section 22 report, and what was their reaction to that, if anyone recalls?
Well, I'll start. I cannot give you an exact date on which anybody was made aware of the Section 22, but perhaps, David, you have better memory than I am.
I would have to come back to you with the exact date. But to answer your question, I think the email that had appended the Section 22 was to make clear to inform the sponsor division of the Section 22. I can confirm that I think it was on the Monday, Mr. Green, and I can remember phoning the then deputy director on the Friday to make clear of the Section 22, having realised that there wasn't correspondence between the then former CEO and the sponsor team. So it was early December. I'd have to get the exact date for you.
But he resigned as a result of it. That's what it says in an email from Mr. McRae to yourself, Mr. Sati, on Wednesday, March 20th. David, as you're aware, the CEO tendered his resignation in December following the pending Section 22 report from the Auditor General. So your view is that the Section 22 report was the trigger for his resignation?
Can I answer that? The CEO, former CEO, resigned, and he stated that he felt he had set up Wix. He had worked there for 24 years. He felt he had outlived all he could do for Wix, and he therefore tendered his resignation. There was no specific linkage to the Section 22.
You made the link. So why is that?
I'm sorry?
You made the link, though.
I've stated in my email following. That doesn't mean there's a link.
No, it states it here. This is an email from yourself to Mr. Sati sitting to your right. The CEO tendered his resignation following the pending Section 22 report. So was there a causal link between the Section 22 report and his resignation or not?
The words are accurate. He did resign.
What is your opinion then on that?
You'd have to ask the former CEO why he resigned.
Okay.
I don't have an opinion on that.
Do you think it was related to the content of the Section 22, which clearly highlighted a number of the issues that the committee is interested in?
The board had received, I had received his resignation, and I then had a board meeting, and the board considered his resignation, but also considered, well, I'll come back a bit. Mm-hmm. We considered his reaction and the executive's reaction to the Section 22. We were in the process of considering that reaction and how good it was and how effective it would be. And hadn't come to a conclusion. At that point, he resigned.
What other options did you consider as a board other than accepting his resignation?
Well, this is... If you like, if you'd allow me, Convener, I would like to give you some extensive detail on this.
A lot of time, so I mean,
you asked me a question.
You could summarise what options were open to you, so we can get to how you came to the decision you did.
The board decided to accept, decided to accept his resignation after extensive discussion of all the options, which have been laid out in detail in the business case, of which you have a full copy, including a detailed value for money set of calculations, which show very clearly that the option we chose did produce the best value for money. You have a copy. We have redacted only 125 words out of a total of 2,494. A number of options were looked at. The option, for example, which has been discussed, of dismissal, would have incurred twice the cost of the option that we chose. However, I would say there were no grounds of gross misconduct. We took extensive legal advice on all of these options, and the option we chose was very clearly justified in the value for money calculations, which I hope you've seen, Mr. Green.
Just to backtrack a little. Is dismissal and gross misconduct two of the same or two separate?
You could have dismissal without gross misconduct. There was no gross misconduct. You could have dismissal, but that would have meant a payment of a 12 months salary, which was considerably more than what we eventually agreed. So that's why that option in value for money terms was twice as expensive as the one that we chose.
So who decided that there was no grounds for gross misconduct?
We discussed it amongst the board and took evidence from our legal advisors as well, a specialist in employment law.
And would spending tens of thousands of pounds on a corporate credit card, on lavish meals, first-class travel, fine wines, etc., having no accountability, seeking no approval, and that are then highlighted in a fairly damning Audit Scotland report, those aren't grounds, for example, for dismissal?
Evidence of gross misconduct.
Right. So talk me through what happened next. Those options were debated and a final option was chosen. That option was a settlement agreement, I understand. Is that correct?
Well, let me, Convener, if you'll allow me, I would like to explain that.
Yeah, as long as you're not reading out a rehearsed contribution, we'd like you to answer the questions we are putting to you, Mr. McRae.
Thank you, Convener.
I'm going to answer the question. The CEO's contract required him to give 6 months' notice, and that would have him working as CEO in post until June of this year and been paid for 6 months. So the board decided, rather than that, we agreed to pay him 6 months' salary in lieu of notice, his contractual entitlement. And this is the key point, provided he departed by the 31st of December. Now, you can ask, why did we have a settlement agreement? That's what you really asked. The departure date of 31st December was guaranteed by that settlement agreement. It allowed the board and Wicks to quickly refocus on value for money and produce an action plan to respond to the Section 22. It allowed the board to proceed with the process of appointing an interim CEO and changing the culture, which we've heard quite a bit about. It protected the interests of the CEO, of Wicks, beg your pardon, and achieved best value. And that was demonstrated in the 10-page business case with accompanying full calculations, which we submitted with only a very small amount redacted. As I said, 200 and... let me get the figures right. 125 so works out of 2,494.
Thank you very much. Let's go through this logically then. And it's important we do this in a logical order because I'm trying to get to the nub of the decision-making. You coming to that conclusion, what happened next? Did you seek approval from the Scottish Government in accordance with the Scottish Public Finance Manual?
We took external legal advice which confirmed that the board had the power to make this agreement. Although we didn't need to, as confirmed by legal advice, we did seek approval from the sponsor team for this approach. The approval was given in a phone call between the deputy director, the senior sponsor of the sponsor team, and a fellow board member, and myself, on the 19th of December. It was confirmed in a second phone call with the deputy director and myself on the 20th of December, and he had contacted the Scottish Government P unit. And the deputy director used the words, and I quote, "You can do this."
Was any of this in writing? Sorry. Was this all done over telephone calls?
It was two telephone calls, and the first one was with myself and a fellow board member, and the second was with myself. The same day, the Scottish Government spokesman announced that the CEO had resigned and used the words, and I quote, "with immediate effect." So clearly, the deputy director had been in touch and communicated the board's approach to payment of 6 months' salary in lieu of notice, provided he departed at the end of December. He also advised us to take legal advice. We went ahead and drew up the settlement agreement, and the reason for doing that was to guarantee his departure at the end of December and protect the interests of Wicks. Now, when it came to the payment, which was supposedly in the third week of January. Although we did not need to, we contacted again the Deputy Director for approval of the payment. The response from one of his team asked for a business case. Business case was sent to the Scottish Government, and a response was received from the Cabinet Secretary some 8 weeks, one day later, on the 15th of March. In the interim, we had verbal confirmation from the Deputy Director that Wickes had the powers to act as we did. We also discovered...
Sorry, can I just stop you there for a second? There's a lot on this. Did the Scottish Government approve the business case or not?
Well, you would have to ask the Scottish
Government. Okay, let's ask the Scottish Government. Did you approve the business case or not?
So can I take that? So the business case was submitted after the settlement agreement was signed. And it's also, so ministers do not have, Scottish Government doesn't have a role in approving it. We have a role in providing views on it. That the nature of the departure of the CEO is an issue for the chair and the board. But in the case of the settlement agreement, the Scottish Government is to provide views on the case.
So how can you provide a view on something being presented a business case after the deal's done?
So that's quite difficult.
Yeah, so that's correct. So there's a chronology here mm-hmm. that is important. Clearly the views of the Scottish Government should be sought prior to entering into a firm legal agreement of that nature. And the then Cabinet Secretary was very clear about her extreme disappointment that due process had not been followed in that respect and that the Scottish Public Finance Manual had not been complied with.
So the payment was made, it was too late, the ship had sailed. So Wickes then came to you, the board came to you, or someone within Wickes came to the government with... looking for retrospective approval of a business case for something that already happened, is that correct?
But my understanding is it was retrospective approval of the payment that followed the legal arrangement that had been entered into.
The letter from the Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing, Economy, Net Zero and Energy, Ms McCallan at the time, in March, to yourself, Mr McRae, as chair, is quite damning. Do you have it in front of you, this letter?
I know the content.
Okay, so let's look at the letter. First of all, the Cabinet Secretary seems to imply that she's pleased that the CEO has exited with immediate effect, given the serious nature of the failings that were identified. But it has been brought to her attention that in choosing a settlement agreement to conclude the departure, the board... failed to follow due process. I'll repeat, the board failed to follow due process. Do you accept that the board failed to follow due process?
I have given you the time series of events.
Yeah, I know that, but do you
go through
those
again?
You're welcome to push back on the Cabinet Secretary's comments, but do you accept her comments, or do you agree that you did fail in following due process?
We and I followed the process in that I've given you the evidence that we... had confirmation of the approach on the 19th of December and the 20th of December, and we then applied the business case for the payment, and that was applied and written up and supplied to the Scottish Government, and we had a response from the Cabinet Secretary, as you suggest.
Okay. So you don't accept that the board failed to follow due process? You think you did follow due process?
I believe that we acted in the best interests of everybody and achieved a result which proved best value for money, and have evidence that we received approval from the Deputy Director on the 19th and 20th of December for the whole approach, including the departure date of the end of December, which could only be guaranteed by a settlement agreement.
It's quite unusual for the chair of a public body such as this, the board of a body such as this, to take umbrage with a cabinet secretary, a government cabinet secretary, on their assertion that the board has not followed adequate processes for settlements such as this. And indeed, your evidence this morning seems to push back on this and be rather in the defensive terms rather than accept that failings occurred in his departure. Why is that? It's unusual.
I had a verbal confirmation of approval of the approach from the Deputy Director, and that be confirmed by a fellow board member. Can I also suggest to you that the public finance manual actually could not be followed because the business case had to be signed by the accountable officer. Mm-hmm. Now, the business case was about the accountable officer, so that was an issue. The other thing is that we had firm legal opinion received from our own legal advisers and also Scottish Government that even if the business case had not been approved, then the public body can go ahead and make the settlement agreement and make the payment.
Ms Quinn, are you satisfied with that response?
So I'll ask my colleague, Ms Burge, to come in a minute. But my understanding is that the conversation on the 19th of December, which I wasn't party to, referred to the resignation of the former CEO. And I think that was accepted, that the resignation, that the former CEO would resign. My understanding is that the matter of a settlement agreement was not presented to the Scottish Government until January, and that was subsequent to the arrangements that have been discussed. The Public Finance Manual is clear in that it requires the Scottish Government's views to be sought. It actually requires the Scottish Government's views to be sought before the details of a settlement agreement are agreed or offered to an individual. So not just signed, but offered. So it is absolutely explicit in that regard. In the event that the board felt that, or individuals felt, that the Public Finance Manual could not be complied with, I would suggest that it is a matter of good governance then to come back to the sponsor and receive advice on what they should do in that instance. That before the settlement agreement. That's my understanding. But I'll ask my colleague, Ms Byrd.
So I can confirm that. So my understanding, again, this was in a conversation which I wasn't personally in, was that the Scottish Government, the Deputy Director, confirmed that Wickes was entitled to pay the former CEO contractual terms, so lieu of notice. So it was that they were entitled to do that. I am not aware personally that the conversation or assurances went beyond that. But as I said, I wasn't in that conversation.
Does this not all paint a picture of some wider issues? Two in particular. One is issues around the board's oversight of what's going on operational level at Wickes. And the second is the breakdown relationship between the sponsor division, the Scottish Government, and the board itself. And I'm going to ask each of you to comment on this. But Mr McCrae, first of all, given the content of the Section 22 report, the numerous references to things like culture and behaviour and patterns of culture and behaviour, which clearly didn't happen overnight, but had developed over a period of time, why did it come to this? How did we get to a scenario where you needed a Section 22 report and some external auditors and the resignation of a CEO for things to change? What on earth was the board doing for all those years?
I'll ask Robin here to comment again as well, but can I start by saying that can I go back to the agreement which was signed? And I reiterate that I talked to the Deputy Director and received approval for the process and had that confirmed in the following day on the 20th of December. And the first meeting was with myself and a fellow board member. At that time, we took the clear view that we had communicated the departure date of the end of December has been absolutely essential, and that was well understood by the Deputy Director at that meeting. Now, the settlement agreement was designed to guarantee his departure by the end of December, which was actually acknowledged by a government spokesperson just prior to that. But going on to the board, the board did not find any evidence of gross misconduct. We did have questions about the CEO's ability to instigate change as a result
of the Section 22. That was a factor in us coming to the view that we should accept his resignation.
So the Section 22 was the trigger for you to have concerns about culture and behaviour at Wickes. Nothing that happened before that raised any red flags.
As a board, we had no reports from Audit Scotland, for example, up until the end of December, and we had never had any accounts qualified in any way. And also, we had no reports from internal audit about any issue with expenses and the sort of behaviour that you've just talked about. We did have evidence from various staff surveys that there was work needed to improve on communications, and there was a better attitude required to value for money, and we needed to tidy up the expenses process. All that was in train at the time. So now, Robin, do you want to comment on?
It was described by the in open correspondence as a toxic environment.
Well, that was from an individual within the organisation. That was
senior individual.
Yeah, everyone's entitled to their own opinion, and there's no one sitting here is saying that this was all perfect. Far from it. Okay, so you've got to go back to the reaction we had. I've said already, back in 22, we were on the case on expenses, trying to get everybody and the expense process in line and everyone between that set of lines, including the CEO. Personally, as a chair of ARC, my whole time was spent trying to introduce stronger processes, better accountability, tracking of actions and things to get to that point. I think you've heard some evidence of the CEO's interpretation of some of our policies would not be the same as the board if we'd been aware of that interpretation. And so for you to represent it that we're all just sitting there waiting on Section 22, we were already in action. We already were working hard to improve the working relationship, improve some of the things that we saw that were deficient. The note from Richard Smith, and Richard Smith spoke to me back in the end of October, prior to the Section 22, quite unusual for the auditor to call up and ask for a meeting. So we had a meeting and he laid out a whole series of things which he described as a pattern of behaviour. And the behaviour concerned me. So when the Section 22 came through, as a board, we jumped on that really hard. And we said, my initial reaction was to get Grant Thornton, say, I want an internal audit. I want to go right down to the last squeak in the pig to find out what on earth has been going on. Because previous audits had not... We knew we had minor issues here and there, which is why we're adjusting the expenses policy. We didn't know the full extent of it. And the document that was created by Wicks has been the source document for Grant Thornton and external audit to, rather than have a sampling audit, to have a full audit of every single transaction. Quite unusual.
Right,
so that generated a lot of action. The board called in the leadership and said, you need to go away and come back with a strong response, an action plan. And that was the genesis of the action plan that David has been following with his staff there. We're doing a great job. Basically, we had everything up, the drains up, everything was up and everything was being changed. So hats off to the staff for what they've done over the last 6-9 months. That was our response. That was what we kind of called phase one. Let's deal with that. The second phase was much more, let's deal with some of the cultural issues that have been left based on the culture that the CEO established. Mm-hmm. And that's why we reacted. We were already concerned, not so concerned we were going to haul him in and sack him. We didn't have evidence or basis for that. But this pattern of behaviour, the response to the Section 22... And his reaction was, I'm going to choose to resign. And we thought, okay, well, let's talk through that. And yeah. Donald and the board navigated through that process.
Thank you for that update. And in the interest of time, my final question is to the Scottish Government itself. Ultimately, responsibility for public bodies and the oversight of the boards who oversight the public bodies is a matter for the sponsor division, the Director General of those directorates, and ultimately ministers and cabinet secretaries. It sounds to me like there has been extreme catalogue and litany of failures of fiscal governance across a publicly funded and taxpayer funded body. At what point did the Scottish Government feel like things were going wrong at Wickes? When did they get an idea that there were issues, or was it solely as a result of the work of Audit Scotland that raised these flags to you?
So I'll maybe start with this answer, and then I'll bring in my colleague. I think it is important to recognise how accountability is set out here. Public finance manual is clear on the accountability of different individuals. Furthermore, the Wickes framework document is clear that the chief executive as accountable officer and the chair are personally accountable to Parliament. The board itself has a number of responsibilities, including ensuring that effective arrangements, I'm quoting from the framework document, ensuring that effective arrangements are in place to provide assurance on risk management, governance and internal control. And in doing that, they must demonstrate the high standards of corporate governance at all times, including openness, transparency in its decision making. Clearly, that didn't happen. Over and above that, the chair has responsibility for the individual performance of board members, including the chief exec. And individual board members should act in accordance with the responsibilities of the board and comply at all times with the code of conduct adopted by Wickes and with the rules related to the use of public funds. So our then Cabinet Secretary, in the correspondence you referred to in March, referred to a recurrent breach of process. And that's what we've seen here, and specifically in reference to the settlement agreement that you referred to earlier.
For interrupting, but can you not, if the Scottish Government's view is that there's a recurring breach of the governance framework and major issues from the top down, can you not do anything about it? There's no recourse for these constant breaches.
Well, we are currently undertaking a number of reviews, and I'll ask my colleague to discuss that with you. But what is clear here is that the board had a duty of transparency and openness, which they were not delivering upon. I'll ask Kirsty to come in there.
So we've commissioned an independent review of Wickes, which is considering the factors that gave rise to the issues that we have seen and obviously that we have discussed today. And this will enable us and indeed Wickes to determine whether any further action is required as a result of that. I think the other thing I would say is, because you asked about Wickes, but you also asked about the relationship between Wickes and the Scottish Government. And look, I think we all have lessons to learn from what has happened. So there were shortcomings in the way in which we carried out our sponsorship function in Wickes. I think, you know, part of sponsorship function is to provide support to the organisation, but it is also to provide constructive challenge. And I think there were instances where we did not do that. So we have made a number of changes to how we carry out our sponsorship arrangements. So we took immediate action after the Section 22 report and put in place much more formalised and robust processes. So regular engagement between the DG and myself and the chair and the interim CEO has come in. We've been setting out clear roles and responsibilities within the Scottish Government. We've made sure everybody has done the training, which part of that training is it's about processes and procedures, but it is also about the culture and the way in which we challenge the organisation. So I think that's really important. And just, you know, some personal reflections for me as well. So I recognise that personally, as the director responsible for this area, I should have provided more assurance and oversight to Wickes as well. But I go back to what the DG said around accountability and accountability in the first instance, because it is not Scottish Government's job and role to scrutinise all elements of expenditure and all elements of training. But what we do want to ensure that is that the proper governance and processes are in place, and that when risks and issues like the ones we have talked about today arise, that they are flagged to the Scottish Government, or we discuss risks openly with the Scottish Government. So lessons learned for us as well, and we have worked very hard put in place a number of changes to make sure that we have robust, confident, strategic sponsorship, and we have reset our relationship with Wix in that respect.
I'm grateful for your humility in that respect. Thank you.
And can I just complete that? Our focus now is very much on ensuring that we have a sound system of internal controls in place in Wix, and that they are focused on delivering best value. After what we have learned through all of this, that they are underpinned by that culture of openness and transparency. And similarly, that there is a culture where that constructive challenge and support from our own sponsorship function can exist comfortably in that space, and that the culture accepts all of that.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. In the interest of time, I'm going to go straight to Graham Simpson, who's got the final round of questions to put to you. Graham.
Thanks very much, Convener. I just want to sort of follow up on Jamie Green's line of questioning, because I think there were aspects there that, to me, weren't fully answered. I mean, Jamie Green put to you, Mr. McRae, whether you accepted in the letter from Mari McCallan, do you accept that you failed to follow, the board failed to follow due process? So that's a straight yes or no. Did you fail to follow due process?
I got permission from the Deputy Director and approval on the 19th of December and the 20th of December. I acted on that and the board acted on that. You can actually ask my fellow board member to see if I did all of that.
No, I'm asking you. Did you fail to follow due process?
I got permission from the Deputy Director 19th of December and the 20th of December, and I followed up with the settlement agreement.
You've said that several times.
Yeah.
In your view, is that due process?
In my view, I did the right thing and followed the correct process in getting approval from the sponsor team for our actions.
And was that in relation to the settlement agreement?
I made very clear during that discussion that we were going for an agreement which would mean departure by the end of December. That was part of the conversation.
Ms. Quinn, that doesn't seem to be your understanding.
That's not my understanding. My understanding was that what was discussed at that point was that the contractual terms would require 6 months' salary to be paid. But my understanding is, and I wasn't privy to the conversation, but my understanding is that a settlement agreement, that phrase, that terminology, that methodology was not discussed or presented to us until January.
And Mr. McRae, you're saying that is not correct.
I'm saying I got permission from the Deputy Director on the 19th of December and the 20th of December.
Are you saying that Ms. Quinn is wrong?
I'm saying I got permission from
Are you saying Ms. Quinn is wrong?
I got permission from the Deputy Director on the 19th
of right
December
or wrong?
And the 20th of December.
Is her version of events accurate?
You would have to ask the Deputy Director.
I'm asking you.
He's not here. I'm asking you.
Is that version of events accurate?
I'm giving you what I did and what discussions we had on the 19th and 20th of December.
Right, you're prevaricating, I'm afraid, Mr. McRae.
I'm giving you the truth and the actual events that happened.
Well, you're not answering the questions. Do you accept in the letter from Mari McCallan, She talks about a recurrent breach of process. Do you accept that there were recurrent breaches of process?
I have asked for confirmation of what was in that letter, so you'd have to ask the Scottish Government or the Cabinet Secretary for confirmation of that. or what was actually meant.
Well, you've heard already.
It's not up to me, Mr. Simpson, to interpret what the Cabinet Secretary says.
Do you accept there were recurrent breaches of process?
It's not up to me, Mr. Simpson, to accept or
You're the chair of the board. Were there recurrent breaches of process?
I don't know what was meant by that letter.
Well, let's ask the government. What was meant, Ms. Quinn?
Well, I think the letter in itself is clear. It says, in particular, I note that in choosing a settlement agreement to conclude the departure of the former CEO, the board failed to follow due process. So I think that's clear.
Yeah, that's pretty clear. What's your response to that, Mr. McRae?
Well, my response is that I did follow a process of gaining approval on the 19th of December and the 20th of December, and then followed that up with a settlement agreement and a business case for that. That was all done following the manual in as much as it was able to be followed.
Does the Scottish Government still have confidence in Mr. McRae as chair of the board?
My colleague mentioned that we are doing a full review of Wicks at the moment. I don't want to prejudge the outcome of that review, but we will consider all of these matters in the round once we have concluded that review.
And do you have the power to remove a board chair?
As I said, we'll
do you,
revert.
Do you have the power?
We'll revert to you. I would need to come back to you on that.
Okay, so you're not sure if you have the power?
I'll come back to you on it.
Okay. And Mr. McRae, have you considered your own position?
I have considered my position over many times over the last number of years.
But you're still in post.
I have not had any indication from anybody that I have and done any gross misconduct, Mr. Simpson.
Okay, and you don't think the former CEO was guilty of gross misconduct? Did he do anything wrong that would have merited him leaving the organisation?
Nobody has a perfect record, including myself, and I'm quite sure that everybody will have done something wrong, inverted commas, at some point. I accept that he did very well in many areas of economic regulation, but there were certain areas, particularly with the culture, that there were question marks. In particular, over how he would react to making the change that was required after the Section 22.
And you said earlier you didn't think there was any link between him resigning and the Section 22 report.
Yeah, I said that, and I still hold to the view that the board as a whole, were looking at his response to the Section 22, and we were in the middle of doing that and considering how effective that would be when he offered his resignation. We hadn't come to a view, and you can ask my fellow board member to confirm that.
And are you telling us that there was, when that Section 22 report came out, are you telling us there was no conversation with the former CEO? You didn't go to him and say, look, this is damning, you know, it really looks bad for you. Don't you think it's time to walk the plank? There was no conversation like that. He just resigned.
We had extensive consultations with the CEO at board level, and the CEO was asked, along with the executive, to produce a reaction to the Section 22 and what changes he would instigate. And that took a period of time, and during that time, I received his resignation. And then the board went ahead as I've outlined.
And was it suggested to him that he might want to resign?
The board were considering his reaction. And
no, I asked you, was it suggested or was it talked about when you spoke to him that resignation might not be a bad idea?
I am not aware of any particular conversation that I had, for example, with the CEO, which said that you should resign. What I was very conscious of was the fact that we had a Section 22, we had asked for a reaction to that, and that's what we considered as a board when his resignation came in.
Okay. So if it was your view that actually he's done nothing wrong, no evidence of gross misconduct, we just happen to have this report from those pesky people at Audit Scotland, and he hands in his resignation, but in your view this is a good guy. He's done nothing wrong. Why pay him anything?
There was no evidence of gross misconduct. There was evidence of behaviour that we wanted to examine and find his reaction to.
So there was evidence that he had failed.
There was evidence that of behaviour that we were questioning, in particular his reaction to the Section 22 and the changes that he was, that we wanted him to introduce. And in the middle of considering all of that, he offered his resignation.
Okay, I've got another question. It's for you, Mr. McGill. It relates to an email that you sent on June the 11th this year, where you refer... I'm just going to read the whole paragraph. I know enough to understand the recipients of these MBA stroke executive training courses did nothing wrong, so no implied criticism from me. As you say, this is to Mr. Satti, as you say, other less well-informed people, brackets with agendas, may profess to see it differently. Who are you referring to?
Well, you just have to open the papers day after day after day to see that people were taking a few dots and really joining them up and coming up with some huge issue. My concern when I wrote that email was that in the middle of all of this, there was one woman in particular who was getting hounded at her front door through no fault of her own, and a whole bunch of staff in Wicks who were kind of tin helmet on, hunkering down. That's what I was referring to.
But who are these less well-informed people with agendas?
Well, they obviously have an agenda because what, in my opinion, they were writing articles and headlines that didn't reflect the truth. And although we'd given them all the information with FOIs and everything else, they chose to represent what happened in a certain way. I would call that having an agenda. I don't think that's an unreasonable statement to make.
Are you talking about the media?
I said just a minute ago, I was talking primarily about the media.
The media?
Yeah.
So the media were less well-informed, and they had an agenda, according to you.
They were extremely well-informed. What they chose to publish would suggest they maybe weren't that well-informed. So my conclusion was, having given them all the information, they chose to publish that. They had their own interpretation of what they'd been given.
Of course they're going to publish it. It was pretty scandalous. It was a story. It's going to get published.
It's absolutely a story.
Absolutely.
And
so that's
as I said,
that's not an agenda. That's just doing their jobs, isn't it?
Okay. All right. Well, then they represent their job in one way. I was concerned primarily for the staff and for the individual concerned, which I think was unfair. But that's what happens when these things happen.
Okay.
We didn't ask for it. We don't want it. And we're doing everything we possibly can to make sure nothing like this happens again.
Perhaps that's why you needed the advice of three times one or somebody like them, so you don't make those assertions again. I'm going to ask you, whoever wants to answer this, about the Grant Thornton audit, which was pretty revealing, I thought. They examined only a sample of items of expenditure, so not everything, and only 53% of what they looked at complied with procedure. So how do we get to that position that just over half? Well, let's say half.
Okay, so the criteria they used to select those transactions were different to the criteria we'd used in our analysis. We gave them everything. They chose to look at a particular... Having been in receipt of everything, they chose to look at a particular very small subset. Yeah, and that subset had a higher proportion of non-compliance than every other transaction. We had 97% compliant transactions in that year.
So
you know, and 99% of the value that was claimed was compliant. But if you dig into the last little bit and explode it up, that's how you get those kind of numbers, Mr. Simpson.
So they looked at the wrong subset. If they looked at everything, it would have been a different
They had
figure.
Access to everything, and they chose to dig deeper, which is they're entirely entitled to do.
That's their job, isn't it?
Yes, absolutely. And we welcome the input from audit, both external audit and internal audit. It's key.
In a number of... I mean, I was going through this. I'm a pretty calm guy, believe it or not.
Right.
And when I was going through this, I found myself getting angrier and angrier just reading it, reading the various items of expenditure. I mean, here in Appendix 3, sampled expenditure with no itemised receipts. A number of things are, well, here's a meal, like Lagerick, Edinburgh, £566, dinner for four people. The conveners mentioned the dinner at L'Escargot Blanc. I don't think that restaurant exists anymore. They can correct me if I'm wrong. Gaucho, Edinburgh, for a Barbados study tour. What was that all about, that particular one?
So this list you're reading from was the list we provided them with, which was examples of meals over £50 a head. Uh-huh. I've got the list in front of me. And we'd already made that available to them, and we'd already sought to understand exactly what was going on there. The Barbados tour was a visiting group of dignitaries from Barbados who were interested in replicating Scotland's water system and wanted to come to us and learn from us, primarily because we have a very good reputation around the world and we represent Scotland, externally at least, in a very strong light as part of our hydronation strategy. So they came to visit, they wanted to learn how we regulated, not how we did our expenses, but how we regulated, and that was a very important visit. And I'm sure there will be more. We often get calls from people wanting to understand what's going on, in spite of all this that's going on, internally.
Yeah. A number of meetings, internal and external meetings, where you've hired places for meetings at various costs. So if we look for, the best value appears to be where you've hired a meeting room from Volunteer Scotland, which includes refreshments for £66, pretty good. But then you go up to, and by the way, I'm not criticising the venues at all. They charge what they charge. These are questions for you, why you've paid it. The Intercontinental Edinburgh, the George, meeting room hire, including lunch and refreshments for, your friends from New Zealand again, a New Zealand study tour, £862.40. Why are you paying that sort of amount?
Yeah,
David, can
I
answer that one?
Yeah, I can answer that. So Wix have operated fully remotely without an office since COVID, and that's resulted in more than £600,000 in savings for the organisation. The other side of that is that when we do have to have meetings, we have to procure or use external meeting rooms like the ones that you're highlighting. What I can say, Mr. Simpson, is that we are engaging, we're at the final stages of engagement with the public body that has our sublease at this moment in time, so that we can actually go back to our old office and ensure that we host meetings like the ones that you referenced in our old office at Moray House.
Oh, okay, so you won't be needing to hire venues like these in future?
We'll be using our office in Stirling.
Okay.
Once we have it again.
Because there are some others which are pretty hefty fees. Kempton, Charlotte Square. We've got Taylor Swift's favourite hotel, where she stayed. The Waldorf Astoria, Edinburgh. I just wondered whether you were doing a recce there for Miss Swift before she came to Edinburgh. And then we move on to various items of training. And I just want to ask you about some of these. We've got the senior manager of central office has two sessions in 2 years on, first is using social media in a public sector setting, and then there's one provided by Talk Action on just social media training. That's £299. The first one was £360. What did he get for that?
As I was saying earlier, Mr. Simpson, we don't have the skills and capabilities in our organisation. We're a small office and we don't have the skills and capabilities to engage in the way not only most regulators but most organisations engage. At the moment, we're using, as discussed earlier, 3X1, but in an ideal world, we would build those skills and capabilities in-house, and that will include in training individuals so that they can do that in a more enduring basis for Wix, rather than having to look elsewhere and buy those skills in-house.
Okay. So having spent money sending someone to get social media training, you'd expect a result from that. But I was having a look at your social media. There has been nothing on Twitter, now known as X, since June 2022. You don't appear to have a Facebook page. And on LinkedIn, which you might use as a kind of business organisation, that's hardly anything. So we appear to have got very little, if anything, for that money. Would you accept that?
What you will see is on LinkedIn very recently the publication of our methodology for the upcoming strategic review of charges, which is an extensive piece of work and has been well received within Scotland, but also within the UK, as you'll read in trade press. And we're also getting inquiries from countries like Romania or in Australia, who are wanting to understand a lot more about what we're trying to do in the regulatory environment in Scotland. So it's clearly having some reach.
This is laughable. I mean, we've spent nearly £600 on social media training, and all the best you can do is refer me to one post on LinkedIn. My advice is if you're sending people on training courses for whatever it is, you want to make sure there's a return for that investment and make sure that they're doing what they've been sent to do. This is rubbish, absolute rubbish. So you need to go away and have a look at all these training courses and ask, what have we got for the essential writing skills workshop? You'd hope that people you employ could write. You don't need to spend 600 odd quid for that. Core financial modelling training, you just go through it. It's garbage. I have to say it's garbage. I'm going to leave it there, convener.
Okay, right, thank you. I think Colin Beattie's got a very quick question he wants to put.
Two very quick questions.
Two?
First one is, we were talking about analysts and so on earlier on. Out of the 21 staff, how many are analysts?
So, Mr. Beattie, we've lost two analysts over the course of the year. We have 9 remaining. So there are a number of unfilled posts at the moment. We have 9, and primarily, well, actually all, they're all graduate recruitments, which does require at times then investing in those individuals.
And my second quick question is, the approval form from the Head of External Relations and Strategy to attend the Executive Development Programme in Colombia in 2019, that cost $23,000. The suggestion in that approval form is that they were a new member of staff. Can you confirm if that's the case?
I would have to come back to you on that, Mr. Beattie.
You know, assuming it is a new member of staff and without casting any aspersions on that person's ability and so on, why would a public sector organisation feel it was appropriate to spend $23,000 on a training course to develop the skill set of a new member of staff?
I can come back to you and confirm. I'm almost certain it wasn't a new member of staff, which may
the form does seem to imply that. But if you could come back and confirm that, and we may have a question to come back to on that afterwards.
Thank you. Yeah, because that is what the appraisal form says: new member of staff. Jamie Green has got one final question too.
Thank you, convener. I'd like to close the session by perhaps
picking up the area that I asked at the closing of the last time we met, and that's that clearly the optics of this are difficult. I presume you would have preferred to have come in today and talked more about the positive work that Wix does and some of the good work that I'm sure your staff do, and we should thank them for that. But the media coverage and the scrutiny at the highest level from Parliament, from government, from the Auditor General must be uncomfortable and difficult, and rightly so. This is public money after all. Do you accept, though, that the optics of all of this has just given off a very, I think, unhelpful view that this has just been, for those at the highest level of the organisation, something of a gravy train for some considerable period of time? And whilst it may have ended, it has happened. And that's the problem. People have lost confidence and faith in the governance of this public body. And the second part of my question is, what happens next? Is there a case for a clear separation of the two functions? One being a body which oversees a publicly nationalised industry such as the water industry and has a very important role to do. But secondly, the more commercial arm of the organisation, which does want to go out and wine and dine and travel for business class, because that's what commercial companies do in seeking new business opportunities. And that the problem is that we've had up until now is that combination of the two, trying to pretend to be both, has led us to some of the issues, as well as the governance issues, which individuals will have to face consequences to, have no doubt. So what should we do next?
Well, I'll start. Mr. Green and Convener, we completely accept, and I personally also completely accept, the need to show greater value for money. I also still suggest that we need to continue to undertake hydrogenation-related activity, but clearly in a way that allows us to separate that in the way that you suggest, because there is a grey area there, and it is quite difficult to combine the two, as you've just outlined, and I accept that conclusion. So that is under review. It's in discussion with the Scottish Government. They can confirm that as well. It is something that is on our horizon and is very important to have greater clarity. And I'm sure Audit Scotland would appreciate that too.
It's not a new discussion. The board has been having this discussion on and off for the last 3 years. Should we, shouldn't we? We're pulling in £1 million. That's a good thing. It puts a strain on the organisation. That may be consequences. So it has been a subject that we've discussed, and we've always sort of said, let's just keep going, keep an eye on it. But yeah, it's time to take a fundamental look, I would say.
The one thing I'd add, if I may, Mr. Green, is we hosted a delegation from Malaysia earlier in this summer, and it was compliant with SPFM. The first thing that they did as soon as they left was declared their interest in engaging with us on a consultancy basis. At this point in time, that's paused. We're not looking to generate any revenue from external parties, not least because we don't have the capacity to do that at this point in time because of where we are in the regulatory cycle and some of the reset that is well underway within Wix. But when we do look going forward, the question that you pose is the right one. Should we be looking at ways, governance structures and potential different structures to host that type of activity?
So thank you for the question. I think it's an important point. I think it's important to recognise that the organisation has been an effective regulator. However, these reports have highlighted issues of propriety and regularity in terms of the operational management of the organisation, and we've had to prioritise stabilising that situation and improving the situation. I want to recognise the work that Wix have done to address some of those issues, and they now have the challenge of embedding those new processes in the wider culture across the organisation. The hydrogenation work is currently being paused. We are taking a view about that, and we'll do so over the coming months, about how that will, whether that will be best, whether that will proceed, and if so, how that work will be best delivered. So that will be considered in the round alongside all of the other activity that is being undertaken at this moment in time. But as I say, at the present moment, our firm priority is about stabilising this organisation and bringing that kind of best value approach to the stewardship of public funds.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Before we finish up, just one final question from me to Michelle Quinn and to Kirsty Berger, I think, because I think, Kirsty, you mentioned earlier on the reviews, and there is an independent review into Wicks, and then there's, interestingly, an internal review of the government sponsorship arrangements. I don't know whether that shouldn't be the other way around, to coin a phrase. But anyway, these two reviews, we were told, Parliament was told, I think, that they would be produced, certainly the independent one, would be published by late summer. And I know we've had a nice week of weather, but we're coming towards the end of summer. When do we expect that report to come out?
Shall I take that? So it is important that these reviews are accurate and transparent, and that we consider all of these issues in the round. So we have seen the initial outcomes of the internal review and a number of the actions we have taken. So to clarify, the internal review is done by Scottish Government internal audit. It is not done from within the DG family. So that's an important point to make. So we have seen some of the recommendations coming out of that and have already acted on them. What we are hoping to do is to be able to share both of these reports with the committee and to publish in due course. And what we are focused on is that we see both of them in the round, and we will share that with you as soon as we can.
But the important thing to say is that we are not waiting until the publication of those reports in order to take action. But we have completed the majority of actions, all but one actually, in the internal review. The outstanding action is to complete the review of the framework agreement, which is underway at the moment. Once we have concluded these reviews, checked them for accuracy and ensured that they capture all of these issues in the round, because we want to do a comprehensive review of all of this, we will then publish both of those reports together and share them with the committee.
But do you expect that to be before the October recess, for example?
I think it's unlikely at this stage that that'll be the case, but we will publish them at the earliest opportunity once we have concluded all of that work.
But do you think it will be November?
We'll have to come back to you on a date.
Do you think it will be before Christmas?
We'll come back to you with the date.
OK, not an entirely satisfactory ending, but OK, can I thank you all for taking part in this morning's evidence session. I appreciate it's been long and at times quite testing, so thank you for your cooperation. There are a number of areas that we will want to follow up as a committee, and I think we've agreed that you'll get some more information to us to help us understand both what's gone on and what's happening. Again, can I thank Catherine Williams, Kirsty Berg, Michelle Quinn, David Satie, Donald McRae and Robin McGill for your time this morning. It's much appreciated. We will consider our next steps as a committee, but I'd now like to close the public part of this morning's session and go into private session.